Hello. Today we're going to be talking about signals and channels, and what we're going to be dealing with are general signals, non-periodic signals, and we're going to look at how to expand what we already learned about Fourier series and how to deal with general signals and how to represent them as wave solutions. So the real question which we might be asking ourselves after all of the lessons we already had is how to represent a signal, so how to apply what we learned from Fourier series about a general signal, so a non-periodic function, like this rectangular signal we're seeing here. So suppose we have a wave packet, so not a wave like we saw before, but a wave packet, so only a localized solution to a wave equation, for example, a rectangle. How do we represent this? So to give you an example of how this may arise, suppose that we have an antenna, we turn it on, we emit something, and then we turn it off. Obviously, this is not a sine wave in the sense in which we analyzed it before. It's not really periodic. It has some portion of the time in which there is a signal, but then it stops. And of course, it is not infinite in time, nor in space. It's localized. So how do we describe such localized signals? And how do we describe, we can call them waveforms, if you like? Well, the answer is not much further from what we already had, and what we're going to do now is generalize our previous developments in Fourier series and actually look at the descriptions of these signals. So first of all, a reminder from high school or first year of university or complex analysis course you might have had is Euler's formula. So as you may recall, in the complex analysis we can actually represent an exponential function through sine and cosine. So an exponential of the type seen on the left here, which has an argument of the imaginary unit times some phase, can be given as the cosine of that phase plus an imaginary part which is the sine of that phase. And so in a sense, complex exponential has real part cosine and imaginary part sine. So again, this I is simply the imaginary unit here, nothing new, so I squared gives minus 1. And if we do this, if we represent the exponential in this way, simply by adding e by the power of I alpha and e by the power of minus I alpha, or subtracting them, we can easily get a formula or formulas for sine and cosine in terms of those complex exponentials. So what does this give us is a way to represent our earlier developments in Fourier series and to write everything a bit more concisely and a bit more easily, you might think. So instead of writing that sum which had an times cosine omega n and bn times sine omega n, so instead of writing the coefficients times sine function and coefficients times cosine function, what we can do is we can actually add these together, since if we represent each sine and each cosine with exponentials, it turns out that we can combine all of the terms in such a way that we redefine our constants, as shown below, and redefining the constants, we have twice as many complex constants, but of course a complex constant is simply a combination of real and imaginary parts, so the total number of constants has not changed, and we can give our function as a much simpler looking sum. So instead of summing over both cosines and sines, we sum over all such complex exponentials, so e by the power of I omega n t, and they have complex constants in front of them. Now, if we go back to our previous analysis, and if we look at how we computed an and bn, they were integrals of the function, respectively with the sine and the cosine, and so it turns out that we can combine those integrals together, and we can immediately evaluate them to find the complex constants. So what we've done so far is a generalization, or in a sense just rewriting, of our initial Fourier series in a way in which we changed the constants to complex ones, and we represented the function instead of with sines and cosines with complex exponentials. Now this may look a bit weird, and you may notice that also the period of integration is shifted, but you can see in the supplementary material how this is done. It's nothing problematic. In fact, what we have considered here is simply a more symmetrical interval. So instead of integrating the function from 0 to the full period, from 0 to t, what we're doing is integrating from minus half the period to plus half the period. So in such a sense, we have just translated the period of the function. We have translated our domain of integration in a way which allows us to have a more symmetrical about the origin integration. And we're going to see why this is useful in a moment. But just for this point, it's important to note again that omega n, which we have not written explicitly in the formula itself, are still the discrete number of frequencies, which are given as twice pi n over the period of the signal. And you may consider, okay, but what do we call the period of the signal here? So when we were speaking in the past what we considered t to be the period of the signal, we were speaking about the period of the general periodic function. But what's going to happen to this period if we consider a non-periodic signal? And this is exactly what we're going to explore. So what we've done so far as a first step was to reconsider the Fourier series from a real sum over sines and cosines into a complex sum, a complex superposition, complex coefficients over exponential functions with imaginary arguments, so I omega t. Now, again, asking the question, what would the equivalent of this be for a non-periodic function? We can ask ourselves, okay, so how do we determine the frequencies for a non-periodic function? So in the periodic case, omega n depends on t, on the period of the periodic function. But what happens when we have a general waveform, when we have a, if you like, a confined pulse, which does not really have a period? Well, then we can't really tell what the period is. And one way of looking at it is considering it to have an infinite period. So what I mean is going to become clear shortly. Now let's just consider our Fourier series for this impulse we saw. So we're not even trying to describe the signal perfectly. We just take Fourier series from this non-periodic signal, which we looked at in the beginning. So taking Fourier series of it, of course, results in a periodic function, which exactly corresponds to our original rectangular impulse around the origin, so in its original domain. But outside of that original domain, we get more square impulses, more rectangular impulses, which corresponds to the fact that we treated this function as if it was periodic. So we only took the part of it which was around the origin, but we did Fourier series, which is equivalent to thinking that it's periodic. So we got a function which is repeated many times, a periodic function. So how do we remedy this? How do we make it non-periodic? Well, the simplest way to do that is actually to increase the period. So what does it mean? Is that if we took the rectangular pulse, but we integrated originally in a larger period, so it's still zero outside of this initial point where the square is, but if we integrate over a larger period, what we get is, again, a periodic function, but with much further spread impulses. So we get infinitely many impulses, so we get a periodic rectangular function, but all of the rectangles are much further spaced. And what we get is, if we keep doing this, so if we keep increasing the period, is they get more and more spaced, and at some point they become so far away from each other, they get so far from each other, that we may consider around one of those rectangles that the function is roughly non-periodic. So this is the trick we're going to be using, this is the idea that we're going to be using, that a non-periodic function can actually be seen as a periodic function with an infinite period. So if you took a periodic function and you took t, or the period, to be equal to infinity, this means that if you had one of its branches, the next one would be infinitely spaced away, and so in essence it will no longer be a periodic function, since you would have to wait infinitely much to see the next period. Now, keeping this in mind, this is the mathematical procedure which we're going to do in order to generalize our Fourier series. And in mathematical language, we should take the limit of the period tending towards infinity. So we should take this lim of t capital tending to infinity, and this is a rather strictly mathematical procedure, but we're just going to go briefly over what we get. So taking this limit, spacing the function in such a way that it effectively becomes non-periodic, and applying this limit to our results for the complex Fourier series, so for Cn, the constants, and for omega n, the frequencies, since omega n depends inversely on the period, taking the period equaling infinity, it actually tells us that it seems that the differences between any two omegas becomes infinitely small. So we see that the omegas become infinitely densely packed, so they become closer and closer together, and they actually turn from a discrete quantity into a continuous one. So our result, when we take this mathematical result, First of all, it turns all of our constants into a continuous thing, into a function. It turns all of the frequencies into a continuous frequency domain, and it turns our sum, which we used to compute those constants, into an integral. So the sum, which originally represented our function, is now actually an integral, and this integral, which you see, the one above, we call the Fourier transform, and the one below, we call the Fourier transform, but inverse, so the inverse Fourier transform. Now, as you may see, we have completely analogous things to those we saw with the discrete case, except that now they look a lot more symmetrical. Now both are functions. We're going to see how we call them a bit later. But essentially, what we have done is we have taken this initial Fourier series we had, and we have taken this formal limit to an infinite time, which represents a general non-periodic signal. And with this transformation, so this Fourier transformation, which we can immediately compute if we have the time dependence of the signal, it actually gives us, again, the constants dependence, except that this time the constants are not a discrete number, cn or an or bn, they are a function and they depend on the frequency, not discretely, so we don't have discrete frequencies, but continuously.